Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us for the Capital Insider series here today. Today we're speaking with Mr. Sandeep Singhal. He is the Managing Director of Nexus Ventures, and I think most of us know him as the most veteran investor, one of the most veteran investors in India, who probably today at Nexus, you know, while I was reading about his portfolio, and I felt, Mr. Sandeep, you had the most enviable portfolio that I looked at in an investor recently. You know, with so many unicorns in your portfolio. And then, of course, you know, I think it's the way you find or qualify founders today before you make an investment, and also how you plan your exits has sort of brought this moment on. And today we are there with him to really know more about how he thinks as an investor. Now, what we all know him as an investor, but probably very few people know that he's actually a serial entrepreneur himself. He started and exited out of his own company. So that is one of the reasons why he understands and knows how to balance between startups and investments and try to make the best of both the worlds. So thank you very much for joining us today, Sandeep. And, you know, we're looking forward to this wonderful conversation with you.
Well, thank you for having me.
So, you know, I think the pandemic is the talk of the town, so to say. And, you know, we've been trying to sort of find ways, trying to find our best resilient moments out of it. But, you know, I mean, on the macro level, what changes do you think the pandemic has brought in the tech world? What kind of tech trends do you see coming up now, I mean, in 2020, in the rest of 2020 and going forward in 21? Emerging out of this pandemic, and you know, what is it that you're looking at? I've been seeing in the last 1 year, there's been a big sort of shift towards quantum tech, which is machine learning, artificial intelligence. So do you see enterprise tech sort of becoming big in terms of both funding as well as tech play overall?
Sure. So I think first, thank you again for having me as part of this series. If I look back, If you see the trends that are happening, I would sort of think of them in four or five major buckets, right? So I think the first trend that I see to your question in terms of technology and what are we seeing with the base of adoption, I think this has been spoken about by a lot of people, but digital adoption has obviously gone at a much faster pace than anybody had anticipated. You know, Satya Nadella's sort of comment that what would have taken 10 years is happening in 10 weeks is a sort of interesting observation, because they are seeing this across all aspects, whether it's consumer, whether it's enterprise, and so on. And in our portfolio also, we are seeing a very significant shift towards companies that are allowing, whether it is a consumer or whether it is an enterprise, to transact and operate digitally, right? So I think that is broadly the first trend that we will see. And this will have a significant impact on India, because so far as an economy, we have been a much more offline economy, right? We have always tried to bring our overall economy onto a digital platform, but with all the efforts that the government is doing, whether it was bringing in GST, whether it was Aadhaar, whether it is UPI, you know, there is a strong friction, there's an inertia in the market. And what this pandemic has done is it's caused the inertia to go down significantly. People have had to change behavior fundamentally. And again, there are sort of these rules, right? That if somebody does something for 21 days, it becomes an ingrained behavior. So in our case, now with a pandemic that's, you know, way past 100 days, we are seeing a significant change in behavior, in consumer behavior, as well as enterprise behavior. I think the second trend that I'm seeing that is tied to this is that digitization is now going more and more towards the masses. So you're seeing rural markets will have a significant impact in terms of our next phase of growth. So whether it is payments, whether it is commerce, whether it is education, whether it's healthcare, so all these sort of, you know, industries which have so far found it very hard to penetrate non-metro markets will see an opportunity at this time. So entrepreneurs that are thinking along those lines and are able to build models which can be monetized, you know, where again, outcome-led opportunities, right? So education and healthcare are very outcome led. So if you can show value to the end user is willing to pay. And one of the challenges, again, we have seen in the Indian sort of environment when we have been investing, is outside of the large metros, the ability to pay has always been questioned. And I would argue that that ability to pay isn't necessarily about the individual's ability to pay, but it's an ability for a business model to convince that individual to pay. And so with the change, with the shift towards digitization, I think there will be an opportunity for entrepreneurs to build brands, to build that value proposition, to build that trust with a wider group of people using a digital platform, and therefore get those people to pay. So, you know, interesting trends we are seeing, you know, with agricultural technology, right? So all of a sudden in the last year, I would say, agri-tech is this was a hot space. You know, we started investing in this a decade ago. We were too early from a Nexus perspective, but we are seeing that there is a significant adoption of technology by the farmer. Now, you know, how do you get that farmer to pay? So those are the things that people are working through right now, but I think there will be opportunities there. The third area is going back to this notion that, you know, you have to build a brand and create a value proposition that gets people to pay, is there is going to be increasing consolidation. So you have to think about, if you are a startup and you're building a business at this point, you have to start thinking about who your competition will be. You know, I would say 5 years ago, nobody would have thought that I'm going to see Reliance as a competitor in education. I'm going to see Reliance as a competitor in healthcare. I'm going to see Reliance as a competitor in, you know, various spaces, right? Which, or even retail, you know, retail, they've been there longer, but a JioMart, nobody could have imagined, right, that this would come. But in some ways, what is happening is, if I'm sitting in a small town in Punjab, or I'm sitting in a small town in West Bengal, who will I believe when somebody says, okay, pay money out of your pocket to buy something? Will I believe a large brand, or will I believe a small startup? And so again, there is consolidation happening because of brands' ability to have wider reach. And so you are seeing some of that consolidation play out in education, technology, you know, both Byju's and Unacademy have been acquiring businesses to build their capabilities because they have built brands. I think those sort of three areas, right? Fourth, I think you brought up this question of quantum tech and, you know, AI, machine learning, all of that. Now, interestingly, there are people who are using that in reaching out to consumers, reaching out to enterprises and so on in India, but there isn't that much core technology development that's happening. I think the core technology development is still much more in the Western markets, but adoption is happening in the India market as well, right? The country has been typically data poor. We didn't have as much data, and to really do machine learning or to really do artificial intelligence on top of the machine learning, you need the underlying data. You need to have the ability to train the machine learning algorithm, and you need data for that. So again, in the last 4 or 5 years, we have seen a lot more digital data being created. So today, the next generation entrepreneurs that are coming in are thinking from day one on how they would build their products based on the data that they're collecting from the market. So you're absolutely right that there is going to be a lot more adoption of AI and machine learning in the Indian context. As more and more of the adoption happens in the use cases, you will also start seeing entrepreneurs building the underlying technologies, right? So if I'm using it for retail, or I'm using it for financial services, or I'm using it for education, now somebody has to provide that technology. So companies are going to emerge. So, you know, for example, we have recently funded a company called IntelloLabs, and IntelloLabs is building a computer vision based quality control platform for fresh produce, right? So basically, think of it, you know, we don't even have digitized supply chains yet. And they're going one step further to say, okay, I'm going to take computer vision to allow quality to be improved across the supply chain. So the question is, what comes first, right? Will the digital supply chain come first, or will the quality tool come first that will allow it to digitize? So a little bit of this in India is happening real time. We are seeing a very, you know, people are sort of working on both sides. You know, you're digitizing, at the same time you're creating the tools to do it. So I think that's the I would say the fourth, you know, to your question. And I would say the last point I would bring up is we are in a global world. So even though there is we are seeing some questions arising because of the way the US and China have had the trade war, people are asking this question that are we sort of deglobalizing in some ways? Will supply chains go local and so on? My belief is that globalization is here to stay. It's just too embedded at this point to be, taken away. And so in that scenario, again, India has to think about its position in the market globally. And entrepreneurs have to think about it and say, okay, how will I as an entrepreneur play in a global market? You can't say, okay, I'm just doing something for India and I'm happy. You know, those days, pre-91 days, I don't think are coming back. So as a founder, there are opportunities that you have right now because of the flux in which you see the global sort of framework right now. You know, we keep talking about the fact that supply chains are going to become China plus one. What role can India play? I think there are opportunities there. How we capture those opportunities is very important. There is obviously China showed that there is a way to capture that opportunity through scale. They just built huge scale. Today, for us to go and create that same level of scale will require a lot of capital. and capital will come to India. But in the interim, how do you compete, right? So I think we have been very, very good at value engineering, right? So I don't want to use the word jugaad. I think jugaad is a negative word because it takes away the quality element of it. But I think we are very good at value engineering. We have shown that value engineering in pharmaceuticals. We have done a phenomenal job on the whole generic side. So I think there is an opportunity to look at ourselves and say, okay, where else can we do value engineering in global supply chains? Where can we bring IP? It could be process IP. It doesn't need to be that we are building the next technology, but we are just improving the way the technology is being delivered. So in that context, we will see a shift in the way IT companies will serve global markets. You know, we're already seeing a shift in the BPO part of the business. So, there's this whole area of remote process automation that's coming in. Argument being made is, with remote process automation, we won't need these BPOs. I don't think that's going to happen. I think it's going to remain a mixture of technology plus people. And so how the Indian BPO industry adapts to that, it will bring new technologies, it will bring new capabilities. Again, there we have a company called Observe AI, which is using voice analytics to improve the quality control as well as the ability to serve global markets from India. And I think that ties back to, I haven't talked about sort of this work from home trend independently as a trend, because I think what I'm seeing when I say globalization is, globalization was thought about between countries. I think now globalization will be between individuals. So, you could be sitting in Delhi, Bombay, wherever else, and you could be working for a company in, Scandinavia or in the US or, in Latin America, and they'll find you. See, today, a programmer has been found in India through the large companies, right? So the value that Infosys, the value that Wipro, the value that HCL, TCS, what they provided was they created a brand for the Indian programmer. That you can hire an Indian programmer, they'll do a good job. Now that you have a million of those in the country, a guy sitting in say Rio de Janeiro can say, I need a person to do this programming for me. I've heard that India has good programmers and they'll be able to find people in India. So the nature of globalization is shifting. It will become much more, not just about country to country or company to company. It'll become individual to individual. So we are seeing that overall shift in how talent will be sort of looked at going forward. So those are some of the key highlights.
No, I totally agree with you. But you know, you mentioned that the globalization will be individual. But do you see this only for programmers, or do you see this for across board for different job yearners that exist today, whether it's teaching or whether it's medicine, doctors? So do you see a broader base also impacted by it?
You're bringing up a very important point, interesting point, right? I think we have talked about medical tourism for a long time. You know, we have seen companies in the education space also try and build cross-border plays. Tutor Vista was an interesting example over there. You're right. We will see some level of, this globalization happening across professions. So the reason why I brought up programming and the reason why I gave those sort of company examples is those companies gave a veneer to the individual programmer, right? It said, okay, if today a person has a TCS on their resume, then a person hiring them in, say, a foreign land will say, okay, if he has worked at TCS, he understands project management, he understands, he's been sort of, you know, that some screening has happened. In the education space or in the, you know, healthcare space, I think there's still a lot of, there's work to be done there, right? We don't have global brands that have met global requirements, right? We don't have healthcare companies which are serving global clients, right? So our healthcare is a very sort of domestic solution right now. But to your point, you know, a person who is a doctor at Apollo or a person who's a doctor at Medanta, you know, they have brands, right? So if Medanta has been serving clients, say in Saudi Arabia or in the Middle East, then tomorrow a Medanta doctor can serve a person directly in the Middle East, right? So it's just a question of how do you build that credibility in a global market? And I see the way it works is, you know, countries build credibility around institutions that's, you know, provide high quality of service, right? So we have seen that high quality of service in the IT industry. We've obviously seen the high quality of that service, maybe potentially in private hospitals in India, but the private hospitals haven't delivered that in global markets. So it'll take some time.
Sure. And I think that would be the day when, you know, talent would really be able to, without moving, be serving in different countries. Yeah.
I think education will happen next. To be fair, I think education is the next sphere where you will see individuals being tapped globally.
And particularly, I think for English speaking countries, because
yes, it's
so much easier. You know, let me also come down to your portfolio. I sort of just touched upon it when I introduced you, but today, you know, you have unicorn companies like Postman, Dhruva, Zomato, Delivery, and you picked them up at a very early stage. I mean, you know, and so, you know, we would like to know, what are the qualities that you see in a founder? I mean, what are the early days? What do you see about or look in a founder? And also, you know, any thumb rules that you have developed on exits from such companies? When, you know, when do you think you exit, or what are some of the variables you see that it's now time to exit or now time to invest? Love to know more about that.
So I think, I think the starting point is a founder who has an ambition to conquer the world, but the ability to focus on the next problem at hand. And there is a reason why I say that, right? So, you know, as an investor, I want to invest behind founders that are targeting large markets, that are targeting huge problems, right? And because if you think about, you know, to get to a billion-dollar company, you need to be in a market that actually at least 10 to 100 times that size, right? Otherwise, people will say, okay, you know, how do you become a billion-dollar business? So fundamentally, these entrepreneurs have to target very large markets. But if you think about it, large markets have many requirements, and you can get lost in trying to meet all the requirements, right? So what the founder has to also do is figure out which of those requirements is going to give him or her a unique advantage. So it comes down to, Sandeep, I'm going to go and change the way social networking is done. Yes, I know Facebook is there, but here's one thing that Facebook doesn't do well, and I'm going to go and solve the problem there, right? So nobody could have thought that TikTok could become as large as it did, right? But they were, Facebook wasn't video first, TikTok became video first, right? So I think those are the type of entrepreneurs that ultimately create large companies, right? They're basically saying, I know it's a large market, but there is one thing that I will do really well before I go expand into and become a, you know, and try and capture that market. So that's the first part. The second part is that person has to have an ability to motivate and sort of sell. And I don't want to use the word sell in a negative connotation. You're not trying to sort of, you know, be a used car salesman, but you have to be able to sell your idea to not just me as an investor. You have to sell that idea to your employee that you're trying to hire. You have to sell that idea to a partner, business partner. You have to sell that idea to your first customer. So there is a need for that person to be so passionate about it that they can sell. So passion flows into selling, right? So, but you have to be, you know, able to motivate or sell a person and create a sense of trust. So, you know, people ultimately work with other people. It's not the idea. See, I'm sure we'll all have ideas, right? I could have also built a magazine, but you were the one who built it, right? So everybody has ideas. But the question that comes down to is, what is it about you that will cause someone to trust you with the idea rather than me, right? So if I come today and I say, okay, I'm going to build a magazine, the person will say, Sandeep, yeah, but you've never actually done anything in this space yet. Why should I believe you, right? So trust is a very important factor. So it's selling, but it's creating trust. So I think that's very important. And I think the third thing that really matters is an ability to listen. And that ability to listen again comes back to, you know, across various areas. So as you come into a market, you have a hypothesis. You come in with a hypothesis that this is the pain point that I'm going to solve, right? Nobody has built a video first social network. I'm going to go do it. But you have to listen. Your market tells you something. Your competition tells you something, right? Your the first engineer that you hire will tell you something. That guy will say, no, you know, you can't build a video that way. You have to do this or whatever else, right? So an entrepreneur has to have a conviction in the idea, but also has to have the ability to listen, to adapt. So what we do, you know, there's no secret sauce to this, is we are bottoms-up investors. So we don't go in with a hypothesis that, you know, education is the next hot area we need to invest in, or, you know, APIs are not going to be the next big thing and we should go invest in Postman, right? So that's not how we look at the market, right? The way we think about the market is the entrepreneurs are the ones who know best. They are the ones who are seeing the problems on the ground. You know, I'm one step removed. I'm not there in the market trying to sort of, you know, solve a problem, right? The entrepreneur is. So the entrepreneur is the one that will really come up with the best idea. So our job is to sort of ask intelligent questions to be able to get to answers on these three or four characteristics, right? That you have the ability to think of the big picture, but so, you know, focus on this immediate problem. You have the ability to listen. You have the ability to motivate. So those are the things that we are, you know, through questioning, we are trying to address. One thing that we are also very, very mindful of is time. That, you know, we will take decisions quickly because we believe that if you don't get a view on an entrepreneur and their, you know, the two or three characteristics that I mentioned early on, it's very, very hard to sort of, you know, change your mind later. You know, sometimes it does happen. Sometimes we have had situations where an entrepreneur may have had a tough day before they came and met with us. You know, they may have had some problem in their family or whatever else. So they don't have a good meeting. And so we'll try and sort of not just make an answer based on one meeting. We'll maybe, you know, sometimes do, you know, two or three meetings, but we'll never sort of string people along, because one thing that we are very, very careful about is that entrepreneurs' time is the most precious thing. And so we want to make sure that we use their time wisely. So if we are doing another meeting, we actually believe that there is a question we want answered, and we would like, you know, maybe somebody else to ask that question than, you know, what I asked you in the last meeting. So that's how we work with entrepreneurs and how we screen them.
And how do you plan your exits? I mean, do you have some sort of thumb rules that you've developed over the course of time in it?
So, you know, one of the, again, you know, we work closely with entrepreneurs, exits are also determined by entrepreneurs to a great degree. You know, you can, as an investor, you can give guidelines, you know, obviously we have a fixed fund life. So we tell entrepreneurs at the time of investment that, you know, we have a 5 to 7 year holding period. And, you know, so the entrepreneurs are aware of that. But ultimately, entrepreneurs have to think of the exits in the context of their own journey, right? So we are only one part of that journey. So entrepreneurs can come and tell us, you know, I don't want to exit this business yet. I think there is still a lot of upside, but I understand that your fund life has some, you know, limitations. So I'll help you find an exit. So, you know, there could be a secondary exit where we sell and the entrepreneur continues. There are other times when the entrepreneur says, you know, I think that what I have built has reached its natural sort of level as an independent business. But if I were to be a part of a larger platform, I think this can be much bigger, right? So they will approach the board and they'll say, hey, you know, we would like to engage into a dialogue with some of the larger platforms and see if we can be a part of a larger platform. Sometimes larger platforms approach you, right? And say, okay, we'll do it. And now I think we're seeing more and more opportunities in the Indian context of public listings. So up to now, most of the exits that you have seen in India have been secondaries. You know, so very few public companies that have sort of really scaled up. So Info Edge, Make My Trip, you know, literally you can count them on your hand, right? There are four or five companies that have really sort of gone public and scaled from the Indian context. But I see that changing. It's changing because you're seeing companies scale faster. So, you know, delivery has scaled amazingly well in the last 4 or 5 years. You're seeing Dhruva has, so you're seeing, you know, you mentioned these companies that have become unicorns. They have all scaled. So it's not just sort of a valuation hanging there, right? These are all backed by actual businesses with, you know, hundreds of millions of revenue, profitability, you know, clear, you know, large customer bases and so on. So these can all think about going public. And the investor base is also changing, right? So today, IndiaMART has done a great job, right? Nobody would have thought that IndiaMART would have scaled and would public, and as a public company, they're doing very well, right? So I think there are, you know, InfoEdge was obviously has expanded and they've also done very well. But I think there are going to be more and more of these companies that there will be acceptance that these companies can go public and be profitable and sustain their growth.
Totally agree with you. And, you know, we would want to see, particularly with the Prime Minister's vision of vocal for local, more such companies from India becoming more scalable. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you mentioned about founders' quality to be able to think with times, you know, for example, Facebook was not a video platform and then it became so because the founder had that vision. But today, in one sense, you know, startups are in a very catch-22 situation because investors on one side are telling them to be a little more, look at their burns, not go overboard with their expansion plans because this is the time more for holding on rather than big growth planning. And yet there are opportunities which are today only in pandemic times, which opens new doors and new windows of opportunities for you. So how do you balance this situation? So how is it that you're telling your portfolio companies to maximize the opportunities and yet not be too extravagant with your investments? And largely how are startups supposed to go?
Yeah, so I think the key thing over here is, so, you know, the decision that's always being made is, you know, growth versus unit economics, right? You have to take an objective view on what your unit economics really are. And the way I tell my portfolio and, you know, how we work with our companies is that think of your business as two parts to a business. There is a steady state business that you are, you know, if today I said I'm going to grow this business at a 10% year on year or 20% year on year, 30% year on year, what would that business look like? And show me what the unit economics will be if you were running a business that was growing 20% year on year or 30% year on year. And the reason why we do that is that's what the public market wants, right? So the public market is looking for a business that's growing 20%, 30% year on year, and they're happy with that. Now that's actually a very good business. If somebody, you know, HDFC Bank has been growing 20% year on year, and look at where it's gotten to, right? So people are not, you know, public markets aren't looking for businesses at 100% growth rate. Those are very few businesses that can continue to scale at that level. So if I look at that, eventually this company will go public, what would it look like, right? That's a steady state business. And then I say, okay, on a steady state basis, what would your unit economics look like? If you come back and you tell me that, Sandeep, I have to give away this product, so my gross margins are zero or negative, in a steady state, that can't work. So in steady state, there is, you know, so you have to sort of go back and say, where am I, what am I investing for growth? And would I be able to potentially today, what I'm giving for free, would I be able to charge for it? Now, what is, how will you prove that to me? You know, how will you prove that to yourself? Forget about to me, right? Forget about the investor. As an entrepreneur, how will you prove it to yourself that tomorrow, if you were to not give it away for free, you will actually, you know, be okay. So do A/B testing, you know, do run tests where you can show that there is, you know, there is some segment that is willing to pay for this. And that segment is right now very small. So for you to grow, that segment has to be grown. So what you are doing is you are investing for that growth by giving it at a lower price. So how you test that, it becomes very important, right? So I think the key thing that we are telling our sort of founders is it's very important to be honest with yourself in saying what is my steady state business and what is my growth investment. And once you do that, the steady state business is all about getting the right product market fit, right? Because the reason why somebody pays is because you have delivered a solution, a product or a service which is providing them convenience, right? And that convenience is what you are showing that they're paying for. So now I have parked that, right? Now I need to just invest to have more and more people get the same convenience. So that is where I think the entrepreneur and the board and the investors and all have to think very carefully. And have I reached a product market fit? Have I been able to show a value proposition for which a set of customers is willing to pay for? And if that set of customers were to become 10 times that or 100 times that, I would continue to get paid and I would build a very successful and very profitable business.
Sure, you're totally right. But then we've also seen startups doing some kind of pivots during this time. I mean, one of the prime examples is Zomato, who jumped into food and grocery because, you know, they had a fleet which could be used for that. Now, such decisions, while at that point of time and during the lockdown, it's very lucrative. But in the long run, do you think it would actually work better for their business? It would be something as a line they would want to go to, and not just Zomato. I mean, it could be anybody. A lot of businesses sort of changed their strategy. So how do you sort of suggest startups to make such pivots and then be able to maximize them? I mean, you know, because sometimes the core business can get impacted by it.
Some of this is the A/B testing that I mentioned, right? That you basically try this out, see how your customer base is accepting the change, right? So if I were, so Harsha or Dipinder or any, you know, Swiggy and Zomato have both done that. You're absolutely right. So there is a delivery service element to their core business, right? So they are saying, okay, I was delivering prepared food. Now, for whatever reason, that business is being impacted either because of lockdown constraints, you know, so people aren't, you know, people don't want to buy, or people don't want to buy sort of prepared food, right? They're concerned, how will that cause, you know, infection or so on. But people have to cook, they have to eat, right? So can I get into the other part? So I'm thinking about this from a standpoint of I am here to meet the need for somebody who's hungry, right? So now I work backwards and I say, okay, hunger can be met by restaurant food. Hunger can be met by ingredients that are required, right? So that's how the thinking starts. So the pivoting so is driven by that. Now, when you go and test that, there are two parts to it. One is your consumer willing to accept your broader value proposition? The customer may have already chosen Big Basket or somebody else, and so they don't need you, right? So the first question is that, are you providing something to the customer that the customer doesn't have a solution for already, or your solution is much better? That's the first part. The second part is, how feasible is it for you to build that solution in a time frame that is given to you, right? So if I am Zomato and it's going to take me, you know, $5 million and, you know, two years or, you know, even 3 months to go build this, should I be doing it? But if it is about just adding a bunch of suppliers to my delivery platform and, you know, start providing this, and my consumers are willing to sort of, you know, take that as an additional service, it's effectively, you know, from a delivery company standpoint. So if I think of them purely as a delivery company, it improves your, you know, utilization, capacity utilization, right? And that's what drives economics in this business.
Sure. You know, on another front, today, how are you telling your portfolio startups, particularly younger startups, to be, you know, to have more RevOps going for them? How they can probably be aligning their sales, marketing, finance, customer focus teams to come together? And, you know, I know startups have always been sort of, you know, fault finding is done in them to say that they only focus on business and not on revenues. And today revenues are going to be tough. And probably, you know, now that we are in a complete stage of unlock, it's going to be tough. The market is going to be much tighter. So how are they going to streamline their revenues, their teams, and make sure that the focus and, you know, there is less leakage of revenues happening in the system and everybody is aligned to one goal. So what could be good ideas for them?
So I think that's a very important point. And I think there's been this discussion around resilience of businesses, right? How do you make businesses resilient? And interestingly, you know, there's been a sort of a decade where I would say resilience has come from capital raising, right? People have continued to burn money and raise capital, and, you know, how good you were at capital raising ultimately sort of, you know, allowed you to scale and exit. That resilience is shifting more and more towards, you know, revenue and internal sort of accruals, right? So one of the things that we have seen and we have been telling our entrepreneurs that this is a good time to go back and refocus on product and really go back and look at what the market is telling you. You know, and so number one, obviously you have to collect data to be able to figure out what the market is telling you, right? So from a product perspective, put enough hooks into your product that you can start tracking what the market is telling you. If you haven't done that, you do it, right? If you've done that, that's great. If you already have that, then look at what the market is telling you in terms of what they see value in your product. So this goes back to the product market fit, right? And use this time to actually improve your product market fit. So, you know, because it's a time when everybody is careful about spends. So nobody is, so you can, if you are not spending on marketing right now, right, you are not falling behind somebody who's spending money on marketing, right? So the advantage is that you are playing in a level field right now where nobody's spending on marketing. Now, if you're not spending on marketing and your competitor is not spending on marketing, how do you differentiate yourself? And that differentiation will come from the product or the service or the solution that you're providing. So use this time to, you know, whether it's your technology team, whether it is your, you know, delivery team, look at all the pieces of how you are providing your solution to the customer and see how you can improve those. And it's a, you know, it's an interesting time because at the same time, every team is working remotely, right? So you're trying to make changes in your product, development and delivery with a remote team. So in that scenario, it is very, very important that it is very data-driven, number one, right? So when what happens is when it's data-driven, then the likelihood of opinions sort of going all over the place also come down, right? Number one. So everybody's making opinions on the basis of the data that's in front of them. The second is that communication becomes more and more important this time. You know, we are on a Zoom call right now, you know, we are all over Zoomed, but it's very, very important that communication doesn't need to necessarily be face-to-face communication, but how you define the goals of the company as the CEO, how do you define the goals of the company? How do you define the path to achieving those goals becomes even more important because you're not seeing that person on a day-to-day basis. You're not able to, you know, use the softer mechanisms of defining a path for the company. You know, there's a lot of people don't realize it. A CEO walking the floor or the CEO being on a town hall or whatever has a huge impact in the way a company moves ahead. Now in a remote environment, you have less of those opportunities. So you have to figure out how you replace them and what communication mechanisms you create to be able to do that.
I think absolutely. Now cultures have to be built over the screen rather than in the offices. So it's as much harder for, particularly for the founders and CEOs. You know, one sector I've sort of seen made a big comeback during the pandemic is the e-commerce sector. You know, there was huge funding going behind e-commerce till about 2012-13, and then we saw a big slowdown with other sectors becoming more important. And now, but it's sort of come in various branches and, you know, different streams of its own. There's social commerce, hyperlocal, and Flipkart is talking about dark grocery stores now. So do you, I mean, as an investor, are you going to be evaluating this opportunity once again in a different avatar now?
So, you know, we have a couple of players in the grocery space, I would say more than a couple in the sense. So we have Jumbotail, for example, right? They are providing a e-kirana platform and effectively upgrading the kirana store to the next level of data-based sort of, you know, merchandising and customer service. So, and then similarly, we have a company called Goodbox that is sitting on the front end of the customer to the kirana interface, right? So we're sort of seeing this play out in a, so to your point, obviously grocery is one area where going back to my original point about digitization and behavioral change, where we are seeing one of the biggest shifts, right? So the big baskets and the grofers of the world came in at one point. I think they probably spent a lot of money educating the market on how to buy grocery online, you know, and be open to next day delivery. You know, we were all used to calling our neighborhood store and saying, hey, we'll just, you know, do that. Now, and this, you know, we are sort of getting back to this hyperlocal model, to your point, partly because in the initial days of the pandemic, we had supply chain breakdowns, right? And people suddenly realized that these long supply chains weren't necessarily, you know, conducive for their grocery business, right? So you're starting to see grocery sort of return back to a hyperlocal model. And in that context, the consumer is expecting the convenience of online, right? So they're expecting the convenience of online, yet the, you know, advantages of proximity, right? So your local store has to behave like a big basket without having the resources of the big basket, right? So how do you make that happen? So you're seeing value chains are now getting disaggregated and people are saying, okay, if I need to supply the same experience, what parts of the experience and how can I break it and create one part of it? So that's the one big shift that's happening in e-commerce. So I think there is the grocery trend is a big shift. The second trend is around social commerce. Again, I would say it's not necessarily the pandemic that has driven it, except for the fact that you know, it's partly entertainment. You know, so social commerce is as much entertainment as it is commerce, and people have time at this point to do new things, right? So people are trying out these new things. Social commerce has been obviously reasonably penetrated in other markets. So India, you know, as such, is you know, there's a lot of influencer-led commerce in our, you know, in our overall psyche, right? Our film stars, our sports stars are all icons which drive a lot of our branding, right? So if you think about it, the Indian consumer is quite influenced by these sort of celebrities. And so celebrity-led marketing, I think, will grow. And you're seeing some of that play out at this time when you know, people are sitting at home.
I mean, do you see the physical distribution model which was there, you know, with large FMCG companies and manufacturing electronic companies having distributors in the field? Do you feel that these distributors are likely to come online now and become like social distributors to help reach out to their community and sell?
Yes, that I think is already happening. We're seeing that, and we're seeing it across industries, by the way. So we are seeing it in grocery, we're seeing it in pharma, we're seeing it in, what else? You know, I can, so, you know, the even in staples and so on, you know, this new agricultural reforms that just came in, right, with this ability to buy outside of the mandis, I think that's going to have a phenomenal impact on our supply chains. You're starting to see corporates reach out to say, okay, you know, we will build parallel supply chains, farm to fork. So now when you start seeing corporate interest in these spaces, you are already starting to see, you know, digitization in those chains, which will force the existing supply chains to also adapt, right? Okay. So that's one. I think the other interesting thing that's happening is, you know, there is, why did we have disaggregated supply chains? It was driven by two things. Number one is it was driven by the need for credit in the supply chain. So I would have my 10 retailers or 40 retailers, or whatever the number was, who I would supply goods to on a credit basis. And that guy in turn would give credit to the consumers. And it was a total credit economy, right? You were literally getting, you were, somebody would say, you know, send me my rice. I'll pay you at the end of the month. The rice would show up and, you know, the guy would keep a khata book, you know, thing. And at the end of the month, you would pay him. And that guy would then pay his distributor, who would then pay his sub, you know, there were sub distributors and, you know, and so on. Now, one thing that has happened is credit is getting separated. So there are companies that are coming in that are just doing supply chain credit, right? So now supply chains can be, you know, there could be credit disintermediation that's happening. The second issue was bulk breaking, right? So it was logistics. How do you break the logistics down to the level? Now, if you look at what is happening in logistics, again, there is a big shift that's, you know, so you have logistics companies like Delivery and so on that can work with brands all the way from their factory all the way to last mile distribution. So a brand now has a lot more capability of determining where do they want a distributor and where not without thinking about logistics. So both, I think credit and logistic changes are going to have a big impact on our distribution systems. And the third thing that's driving that is the need for data. So more and more brands are asking for data at the consumer level. And the more disaggregated that supply chain is, the harder it is to get accurate data, right? So in the pharma industry, for example, you've seen that, you know, the pharma companies have their medical representatives go to the field and actually try and get data from the chemists, you know, how much did of this particular thing that you sell or whatever, right? And there's all sorts of gaming happening in that model and so on. Now, if there was a way for them to get that data immediately, they would love it. So e-pharmacies gets that data immediately, right? So for both for the pharma company and for the consumer, e-pharmacies are providing a great benefit. So over time, you'll see more and more of that shift happening. Now, if e-pharmacies are there, then the existing supply chain, the chemist and the distributor has to align their model so that they can provide the same convenience as I'm getting from, say, you know, 1MG or a pharmacy. So that shift will happen.
So in one sense, maybe the distribution and retail will converge.
Yes,
in the online space.
Yeah.
So we're getting some questions, Sandeep. You know, maybe you can take a few of them just to answer our audience. So Arnab has asked on Facebook Live, what is the scope of getting fund for a nascent health and education startup in rural area, mainly West Bengal?
So, you know, I think the way you should think about fundraising is depending on what is the nature of your business again, you know, where you are at scale and where do you want to go to. I see most of these businesses start with angel investments. So this is somebody who would, you know, again, understand the West Bengal market, understands the gaps that are there and is willing to fund you to address those gaps. And so I would start with angel investors that understand the market that you're in. So if you're in West Bengal, you know, Calcutta has a group of angel investors. So I would reach out to them. You know, Thai, I think, has a chapter in Calcutta, so they can help you and so on. So I that would be my recommendation.
There is Avinash Mohanty here on our chat who's asking, do you think the pandemic has caused a serious dent in the tech mobility space, particularly self-driven vehicle rentals for the first mile and last mile travel solutions? By when do you think the recovery could happen? do you think investors will be looking to invest in this sector at all?
Again, you know, I don't have a I don't have a sort of, you know, forecasting sort of thing. But what I would say, Avinash, is that if you think about where the world will head post this, you know, pandemic and things opening up, is public transport will reduce and people will want to do more private transport. So in one way, to your specific question on personal mobility, I would expect personal mobility to increase. And this has been proven out in China after SARS. So after SARS, they actually saw increase in personal vehicle sales. And you know, one would expect that there would also, you know, we will see some level of increase in maybe two-wheeler sales or car sales post this pandemic ending. Obviously, the flip side is that, you know, if people's purchasing power goes down, what does that do? But for people that have to travel, there is going to be a desire to be safer, and that may drive personal mobility.
So because you mentioned agri-tech, so Satya here is asking that do you fund, do you see that there's a good scope of funding for hydroponic agri-businesses in Hyderabad?
So, yeah, I think there is a, yes, hydroponics as a category, I think, does have a huge opportunity in India. And in fact, there are many players that are coming into this space from various walks of life. You know, I have now met everybody from a McKinsey consultant to, you know, team from delivery to, you know, very large sort of private equity fund that is doing work in hydroponics. So the whole area of controlled agriculture, in my view, is there is a large opportunity there. The key thing that you have to think through is controlled agriculture and hydroponics is fundamentally industrial in nature, right? You are converting what used to be a seasonal, you know, risky approach and trying to make it into an industrial model. And, you know, industrial models have advantages and disadvantages. One advantage that they have, obviously, is you have the ability to control process. So process engineering becomes very important when you think about controlled agriculture and hydroponics. So if I was an investor, the first thing I would look for, and I would, and I've met many people in this space, is what are you doing that's so differentiated that tomorrow, if somebody comes in, you know, say SoftBank, SoftBank has this investment in a company called Plenty. If Plenty sets up a facility in Bangalore, how would you compete with them? So, you know, for people who understand this space, I think, you know, you sort of understand what I'm saying here. The second point that that's in some case can be a negative is industrial systems work best with fixed pricing, right? So you know exactly what your raw material costs are and you know exactly what your final sort of pricing is, right? So you know how to manage your pricing and your margins and everything accordingly. In the agriculture space, you know, in the absence of everybody doing hydroponics, the challenge is that pricing keeps varying. But your industrial inputs are the same, right? You're spending the same money on seed, you're spending the same money on chemicals and so on. So how do you manage your pricing algorithms to be able to run a business that in the peak season may actually have low prices, but in the non-peak season may give you very high prices, right? So today, if I sell tomatoes, I may be getting a very low price because tomatoes are available in the market. Everybody's growing tomatoes. But in the non-tomato peak season, you can sell tomatoes at three times the price, right? So you have to be able to run pricing models that allow you to take losses in the peak season, but make huge amounts of money in the non-peak season. So if you can think through that, I think there is value in that business.
So we're getting like totally filled with questions here, but I think just 4 minutes more maybe, and we can take a couple of them. So there is somebody who's got a grocery startup, which is like a local online kirana store. So he's asking, what are the chances of customers shifting from big basket like players to local store ordering online?
So the answer to him or her is, how well do you know your customer? The way that a local player can beat the online players is by showing a better understanding of the customer. And I think that's what I would ask you to focus on, is figure out how you know your customer better and what can you show to that customer that will get them to work with you instead of BigBasket. There is obviously one big advantage that you continue to have, which is you can supply in a much faster time than a BigBasket, right? So BigBasket tried to do the 90 minute delivery. They haven't really succeeded at that. So they're still more of a next day delivery, scheduled delivery play, right? So as a local supplier, you can provide much faster turnaround, but you have to understand how many of your customers need that. And, you know, can you build a business around that?
So Rahul Mehta is asking that, what are your thoughts on opportunities in the rural supply chain and logistics in non-agri products?
I think the opportunity is there. You know, people are working on it already. The key thing is to figure out how to build a scalable business here, because rural markets are notoriously different across geographies, right? So what you do in Odisha rural market may not apply to West Bengal, you know, which is right next door state. So I think the key thing is figuring out how you will be able to scale the business, but the opportunity is there. Today, if you want to do something, all the large brands, all the large, you know, Amazon and everybody is looking for rural penetration.
So Deepak Kadam's asking, what are the things startups should be focused on to increase the valuations of their companies before going for first round of investment? Well, everybody wants an answer to that.
So I sort of answered this question early on, but you know, I think to this specific point, Deepak, that you bring up, number one, I would not focus on valuation. I need to get to a certain valuation. I think your focus should be on, am I building a product or a service or a solution that my customers love and are you know, will support me come hell or high water, right? So I think the starting point for a entrepreneur should always be, am I solving a pain point, and is the market telling me that I'm solving the pain point? Because ultimately, when I come to you as an investor, that is my question to you, right? Are you solving a pain point that is large enough? And is the market telling me that you are solving that pain point? And every business is different. So I have an investment in a company called Pratilipi, right? So Pratilipi is building a solution for authors to connect to readers. Okay. So that business, when Ranjit came and met with us the first time, there wasn't any clarity where the revenue will come from, right? So the first question that everybody asked is there anybody that is making money in this business? And the answer is no, right? But what he was able to show was that there were enough people who were reading and there were enough people who were writing. And the numbers were only growing, right? So on a month-on-month basis, there were more writers and there were more readers. And more people were read, and all the readers were reading more than they had read the previous month. So your, you know, time spent on the app, your time spent on the website was increasing. So for us, what really mattered was that there was a clear need that we could see, and there was a clear way that he was solving the problem, which we could see scale, right? And that company has grown, you know, 4 to 5x year on year, right? So every year they go 5x from where they were the year before, right? So in that situation, it has been very, we don't have to go and raise money. People come to us, said, oh, we heard that Pratilipi is growing at this number, right? And Ranjit is phenomenal. He actually publishes his numbers publicly. So you can see how Pratilipi is doing by just going to their, you know, to their sort of portal. And so people write to us and say, oh, we saw the Pratilipi numbers. They are so good. You know, how can we invest? So I think that is what you want to get to. You want to get to people calling you because they have heard that your customers are so happy with you.
Totally agree with you. We have some more questions, but we've totally run out of time, Sandeep. But thank you so much. You know, you're patiently asking questions. And I would request if your team can maybe take a few minutes to answer the rest of the questions. This talk is actually live on Facebook, so we can send the link and maybe some of these questions can be taken there. But thank you again very much for joining us here today. And I think some really important points that you made here today about what sectors to look at and, you know, how do you sort of measure yourself up as a founder and be able to raise investments and really to sort of now conduct business in an environment which is tough, but could be very rewarding if you do it right. So thank you again for joining us. And to all my attendees, thank you for being here both on Facebook Live as well as on Zoom. If you have more questions, please keep them coming. We'll try to get them answered from Sandeep or his team in the coming days, just for you to be able to find your answers and questions you have. Any final words from you, Sandeep, as we call
it? I want to thank all the entrepreneurs that are on this call and listening for your time, and all the best as you sort of keep building your businesses. Don't lose heart if the pandemic has hurt you negatively. I think this will pass. You will have an opportunity to keep building the businesses. And for people who are sort of thinking big and are building businesses, you know, all the best. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sandeep. And thank you to everybody who's been part of this talk. We look forward to more such talks in the coming times. Thank you.